All right, do you have any comments or questions? This is your time to be heard. Come forward, please. You do have a 5-minute time.
Mr. DeCarbo, 130 South Shore Court. This should be a 30-second question. I sent in something to council and staff asking about the northern boundary on the parcel of 1221 Riverside. It was fixed on the GIS map, but it hadn't made it onto the UDC map.
We'll make the change. Okay.
Thank you.
Who's next? Yes, come forward.
Hi everyone, my name is Kendra Cox. I live at 250 Meadowwood Drive. I'm here tonight to read a letter to have it put into the public record. This letter was delivered today to Mayor and City Council from Stuart Teague of Teague and Chambliss, attorneys at law. Dear Mayor and City Council, this letter is written on behalf of Eric Schumacher in connection with the consideration and adoption of a new Unified Development Code, the UDC, by the City of Roswell, and to preserve objections to the consideration of the UDC and the new zoning and development code it contains. This letter is written on behalf of Mr. Schumacher and any other affected citizen of the city that may not be aware of the nature of the city's contemplated actions and the lack of notice. The city's manner and procedure of attempted compliance with the Zoning Procedures Law, OCGA 36-66-1, referred to herein as the ZPL, negates legal compliance with that law. Among other things, the UDC under consideration at the time of the city's readings and hearings on the new code was never made available in any certain form to the public in a manner in which the public could understand the changes to the UDC. In addition, the city's attempted publications of hearings were negated by the city's actions of lobbying the public not to appear at the hearings the city advertised for public input into the UDC. Also, City Council has prejudged the adoption and consideration of the UDC by stating that the UDC under consideration will not make changes to the substantive restrictions and permitted uses within zoning use districts. The written notices sent by the city further made public statements about the UDC to cause the public to acquiesce to the adoption, which statements were not accurate or true with regard to the UDC under consideration. For example, in an insertion and water bill sent to advertise the public's opportunity for input for the August 2013 community meetings on the UDC changes, the insert stated the public need not be concerned with the adoption of the UDC. It further stated inaccurately that homeowners should not be concerned with the UDC changes and that the changes would not, allegedly, change the permitted uses of their properties. Furthermore, on June 27, 2013, the city mailed notices of the consideration and hearings on the UDC to members of the public with the following bold-faced statements. All of the existing rights allowed on the property will remain. This language was followed by a bold-faced statement to property owners instructing them that they do not need to do anything. These statements were in bold-faced form while no other statements in the notice were bold-faced. The statements regarding the effect of the new UDC on existing rights allowed on the property were not accurate at the time they were made. The UDC makes changes to existing rights on the property of landowners in the city. The city's UDC eliminates and changes permitted uses on properties in the city, in many instances, changing the rights of property owners and their neighbors. In fact, a main purpose of the UDC changes was to change the existing rights of property owners. By taking a pro-adoption marketing approach to the notices mailed to landowners, the city actively encouraged members of the public not to participate. However, the purpose of the zoning procedures law is to increase public participation in the zoning process and is not to instruct citizens not to participate. The ZPL was further violated by statements that existing rights would not be changed. This misinformation literally reads to instruct citizens that the UDC did not make substantive changes to the permitted uses in the new zoning districts, when in fact the contemplated UDC does change such rights. Furthermore, the instruction the city's public published notices that the UDC would not make existing changes to property rights could not be made by mayor and council. The city could not make promises to the public during the legislative process that the city would not change existing rights in the property, because such published promises would have constituted a prejudgment of the mayor and city council's actions in amending the zoning ordinance. In other words, not only were the pro-adoption marketing statements false regarding the changes under the new UDC to property rights, but also the statements never should have been made in the first instance. Neither the city nor its employees had any public participation function in making statements in an attempt to eliminate public concern in advance of public meetings and participation. The city is required to restart the public hearing process without sending notices to the public informing the public to the effect that citizens have a right to participate, but you shouldn't waste your time doing so because the city has your best interests in mind. The end result of the city's statements and public notices regarding the UDC adoption has been to prevent persons who are affected by the new ordinance from appearing at and providing input into the adoption of the UDC. The UDC therefore represents the culmination of a process designed to minimize public input. Accordingly, the process chosen violates the zoning procedures law and provisions of the Georgia law designed to preserve the legislative process and the Georgia Constitution of 1983, Article 1, Section 1, Paragraph 1, Article 1, Section 1, Paragraph 2, and Article 1, Section 3, Paragraph 1. The process further violates the rules and procedures of the City of Roswell designed to comply with the ZPL.
You may submit your matter as a matter of record. It will be considered record even though you haven't completed reading it.
I almost did.
You almost did, but you may submit it.
Thank you.
If you will hand it to Ms. Love, it will become part of the record. Who'd like to speak next? Yes, sir. Come forward, please.
My name is Ralph Mills, and I'm a member of the DDA, Roswell Downtown Development Authority. I would like to thank each and every one of you for the incredible amount of time and energy and effort you've put forth to help bring this beginning change to Roswell. This is a very, very important document. Whether it's totally correct or whatever, it's not really as important tonight as the fact that we move forward. And this step that you're taking, we greatly, greatly appreciate it. And once again, thank you very much.
Who'd like to speak next? Yes, sir, go forward.
My name is Lance Ledbetter, 680 Roundsville Road. I'm speaking on behalf of South Creek on board of the Homeowners Association. In that capacity, we've had the pleasure of meeting with Mr. Townsend, appreciated his time. And with that, I know a lot of things have changed, obviously, since we've had the opportunity to speak. But we're very concerned about the timeline which is taking place. We understand, as previously stated, you all have spent a lot of time putting this together. Appreciate all your efforts. But in the same vein, as Councilman Orlans is familiar with, I hate to do a comparison to the Affordable Care Act, which most of you may know as Obamacare, but the thought of us not having an opportunity to appropriately review the final draft as the public before it's actually voted on is, I think, really a serious concern. That said, I understand that UDC technically does not increase the density by its passage. However, it does remove the density limits Roswell currently uses and creates zoning categories that will possibly double or triple in that capacity as far as existing densities allow. That UDC has adopted wording to allow for exceptional circumstances in place of allowing RS4, RS6, and RCC from suburban residential. That the question in that respect is, what are the limitations defined as exceptional circumstances? As I understand it, there are the limitations, and it's based obviously on your all's input on an exception by exception basis. I also understand, correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Davidson, that you cannot apply ruling relevant to exception declining based on traffic issues in and of themselves, which is a serious concern to our area around Saddle Creek. So if you cannot decline a zoning request based on traffic issues alone, that creates a problem for us as well. So the question is simply, what are the limitations related to exceptional circumstances? And the concern currently is property that's within a half mile of our subdivision that borders Chafin Road and Crabapple in Hembury that very well could be one of the first exceptions brought before the council. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Who'd like to speak next? Yes, Counsel.
My name is Clair Snedeker, 765 Whitehall Way. And thank you for the time to address my concerns. Part of the wording changes for RS6 for Ed Cottage Court. First point about key guardian for managing the residential density seems to hinge on the council's interpretation and application of this term, exceptional situations. We've seen what happens to density, like at Rubber Road and House Road, where there's it's extremely troublesome to us as neighbors who've lived in Roswell for a long time, and those densities don't even come close to RS6 for Cottage Court. So my question is, what is the council's intent on administering the exceptional situations? And then one follow-up after that.
My intention is not to increase the density in your neighborhood.
But what about all of the areas that I live in? My neighborhood doesn't end at my...
My intention is not to increase the density in any neighborhoods unless I have strong support from that neighborhood to increase the density.
But there's infill.
When I have a neighborhood, such as Roswell, which supports increasing density, then I support it. When I have a neighborhood that is opposed to it, I oppose it.
Well, there's considerable redevelopment land in the field in Roswell, so that statement doesn't...
Well, I will tell you about our personal field.
Yeah.
I live on 15 acres, two houses. I do not anticipate in my lifetime any increase in density on that 15 acres.
And what about your neighboring areas? And that'll get to my next one, which is, how is the council going to administer adjacency compatibilities in the exceptional situation?
As we have in the past, and this council has been very responsive to the concerns of the community to create neighborhood quality. And I think we have an excellent track record.
I think there are many areas where it's excellent, but I also have the situation at Rucker and House where it's looking at an aerial map, it's not that. I'm also concerned that the exceptional situations might alter the redevelopment corridors, which is what we talked about in one of the meetings before, and just wanted to know how the council would prevent those exceptional situations from altering redevelopment, that you're trying to really focus on the corridor. Because any one deal, like a Chafin Road deal, is an opportunity for being in the corridor, but it may not be.
I anticipate the redevelopment focus being on the Highway 9 corridor south of Horse River Road.
Thank you. So how does that address the exceptional situations in residential?
I think exceptional situations is going to have to be an accepted A very strong argument for higher density, which would include transitional properties which are have strong community support for a higher density because of adjacent properties in higher density. I don't see any significant change in demand. I don't see any real change.
And again, I extend that beyond where my child goes to school. It's a lot of areas, not just my neighborhood.
I wrote an article which said, I don't believe in 95% of Roswell you're going to see any change.
It's gone up since the last time I was here. It's 90, so I like it. Maybe if I come back next time. Okay, sorry. Then on the, is there anything else you were going to say on that? On the buffer area, I just wanted to go back to that again. I was hearing that the buffer situation with the suburban residential was that there are certain topographies where the 8-foot wall and the 20-foot buffer are maybe appropriate, but then there's areas that's not. Why not be in an exception-based code so that you don't fall in the trap where you can't turn it down without, you know, you can't turn it down?
We are not in that trap. We can't turn it down.
I thought can you state that, or clarify that point for me again, though? I forgot to ask that to begin with. Can a type A buffer, you know, zoning request be turned down?
There's always a way to turn down a zoning request. Alderman earlier said that traffic cannot be the only reason. That is true, but there is always a density issue to the traffic.
Right.
Well, it should be turned down, so.
It can be then among other things to turn down, but it can't alone be turned down. Well, again, whatever amendment might be coming or whatever consideration tonight about making that exception-based language, because it seems like you don't have a downside. You have the exception-based, the topography that works, but you don't have to come up with other reasons where it doesn't work. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for coming. Yes, go for it.
Glad I stuck around. Mayor, you just made a very interesting comment that the density, Janet Russell, 260 Willow Springs Drive, Roswell, Georgia. You're welcome. I live in that corridor, the SR9 corridor, south of Oak Ridge Road to the river. You just made a public statement that that's the area that you're going to change the density and make it higher. That kind of concerns me. I've been a proponent, as you know, of pedestrian accessibility for the whole time I've lived here. I love where I live. The city has thumbed their nose at us for the 40 years I've lived there. We don't have connecting sidewalks. Now, all of a sudden, higher density is going to be the answer to everyone's problems, except you haven't provided basic services like the right to walk to the people that have lived in neighborhoods that are over 50 years old. So I'm really troubled, as are the people that live around me, because the traffic on Highway 9 now, in case you are unaware of it, the traffic control device at the river is totally screwed up. And traffic on Saturdays and Sundays southbound in one lane is backed up from the river to Barrington Hall from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. every day, almost completely stopped. I've spoken to Mr. Asenbrack. He has explained to me that Siemens or whoever created this computer, it's not working. Well, that's going to be the norm every single day if you don't control the density in that corridor without providing for the residents that have been faithful people in this community. When people think about Roswell, they don't think about Holcomb Ridge Road and Coles. They think about the corridor that we live in. The old original one. You wrote a long article in the newspaper about how the Presbyterian Church was ground zero and 1 mile in all directions was the village. Well, we already knew that. And now you talk about walk up. It's a great code, that walk urban places. You should have talked to me because I didn't coin walk up. But I've been preaching that, and you all, this city has treated me like a pariah. They have treated me with disregard and disrespect. Because I have preached exactly what you've all had a come to Jesus meeting about. You've discovered the value of living in town. Now you want to pack it in so you can make more money. And as I wrote to somebody, you're so busy listening to the ka-ching of a cash register, you don't hear the very people that have been the anchor of this community. We don't move in and out like all the other people in the subdivisions. We've stuck around and you've done nothing for us, and now you want to pack it in. And you still will do nothing for us, but you will for all these people that may someday move here. In the meantime, the people that live here still get nothing. Nothing. I still can't walk to the river. I still can't walk to the square. I still can't cross Highway 9. No. No. But you can do projects in less than 2 weeks after approving money to build a half a mile of multimodal path on Highway 120 that's across a six-lane divided highway where a River Ridge subdivision opens up. You got it started in less than 2 weeks after approving the money. I waited 3 years to fix a corner of my street that had been destroyed when they put in the water pipes, only because Mrs. Price got it going did we finally fix the corner. Finally fixed the corner. I told you I would get a bag of gravel and a shovel and call Channel 2 News. Mrs. Price heard me and she had it fixed. You people are a joke when it comes to this development part of it. I'm not a malcontent. I've given hours and thousands of hours to this community for exactly what you want. But you've forgotten about the people that live here, that pay the bills. All you hear is ka-ching, 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 ka-ching. Mayor Wood, you live on 15 acres. I would love to see the radio tower there, and I'd love to see some of this high density there, because you'd be the first one who wouldn't break the vote for the radio tower.
Who'd like to speak next? Yes, sir, come forward.
Hopefully Fleck Martin's landing, mayor and council. Hopefully he can get out of here pretty soon. This public format doesn't afford individuals who speak the opportunity to challenge any responses made. Individuals make statements, ask questions, and some of us are quickly instructed to sit down. You all answer, and your word is final. Thankfully, y'all postponed the final approval till tonight, and I wish to follow up on to Mr. Davidson's response to my recommendations. For consideration relative to tenants of the infrastructure sufficiency sections that existed in other cities' codes. Mr. Davidson, your response to my suggestion relative to take a page out of Raleigh's UDC. You stated it can't be a requirement for a developer to pay for systems improvements because impact fees already exist. Seriously, we all know that impact fees don't really accomplish infrastructure improvements, and property owners usually bear that cost eventually. So my intention was not to infer that traffic should be the only thing. I'm certain that you all read Raleigh's code and realized there were numerous recommendations and even methods for traffic analysis. So while paying for infrastructure needs cannot be a specific requirement, one possible option is to ensure that surrounding intersections should be at a specific level of service. I certainly don't have the expertise, but I presume that RDOT does, and would be able to determine the best size for intersections. And if a project is not, then that is substantial evidence against approving that project. I'm not saying that the developer had to pay for it. I'm simply encouraging you all to incorporate such favorable aspects before approving a development anywhere in the city. I am well aware what you all allow with the Lennart project, where the developer basically diluted the 300 peak morning trips into some 10,000 trips per day, insinuating that sufficient capacity existed, even though any rational person knows if you add 300 cars to the morning traffic in that area, it will have a major impact. I would like to know what levels of service requirements exist within RDOT to address these concerns that have been previously stated here this evening also, with peak morning hour trips through intersections throughout the city that are not going to be flushed away so easily.
Who'd like to speak next?
I asked the question. You going to respond to it?
No, sir. Who'd like to speak next?
No response?
Yes,
sir. No response. I wasn't going to vote to sit down. I just said, you don't have to answer.
Hello, Matt, you see overhead projector, please?
Certainly.
Mayor and Council, my name is Nydia Tisdale. I live in Brookfield Country Club. Thank you for this opportunity to speak on the Unified Development Code. On April 17, 2012, Governor Nathan Deal signed House Bill 397 into law. That law is the Georgia Sunshine Law. That is comprised of two components. One is the open records law, and two is the open and public meetings law. And I will put this law on the overhead. An agency means every city. A meeting means the gathering of a quorum of the members of the governing body of an agency at which any official business, policy, or public matter of the agency is formulated, presented, discussed, or voted upon.
If I were arriving at the airport in Miami, Florida,
coming home from the Dominican Republic and they wanted to have proof of my citizenship, I would have to produce a passport. They would not accept a Georgia driver's license. These are two distinct legal documents. They have very similar information. However, one does not satisfy the requirement of the other. Georgia law distinguishes between public notices and agendas. They are two distinct legal documents. I have not found a public notice posted in this building for this meeting tonight, nor for the work sessions regarding the UDCs that I have attended and that I have filmed and posted on YouTube. Again, I caution you that any rule or resolution adopted without due public notice is not binding. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.